Morning, viewers. Welcome to today's edition of Good Health on Vanguard Live. My name is Shola Omodipe, and I'm your anchor. Today we shall be discussing brain drain in the health sector. I have with me in the studio two professionals. They are medical doctors. On my immediate left is Dr. Sally Hussaini. Dr. Hussaini is the chairman of the Lagos State branch of the Nigerian Medical Association. Dr. Hussaini is a general surgeon at the Ikorodu General Hospital. You're welcome. On Dr. Hussaini's left is Dr. Moruf Abdusalam. He is the publicity secretary of the Lagos State NMA. Dr. Abdusalami is a pediatric surgeon at Lasuth. You're welcome, Doctor.
Thank you very much.
So I'll start with you, Dr. Hussaini. We've been hearing in recent times so many stories about doctors leaving the country for greener pasture. In fact, just yesterday we were told that not less than 600 doctors leave Lagos State. Yes. Within the last 1 year. So what really is the, why are we having this development at this point in time? And what are the implications?
To start with, good morning. To start with, we need to actually define what brain drain is. We have the internal brain drain, we have external brain drain. The internal one is such that you have medical personnel moving from state institutions to more comfortable federal institution. Why the external is when you have either of them now leaving the country for a greener pasture. The causes are quite enormous, and the main cause is actually around remuneration. The remuneration to the health providers is quite poor compared to their contemporaries all over the world. The condition of service is poor, the environment for service is poor, facilities available to run your services is also poor. Then the recent attack on health workers is demoralizing and very subsuming for the health practitioner. And indeed, you have situations where even those that are here are actually encouraging more to leave. And the real fear is such that the succession period, the gap between the young ones coming in and the older ones that are in the system is going to have a very grievous effect. Such that by the time the young ones are coming into service, the older ones are leaving without actually putting the younger ones through what they're supposed to. And you're going to have a wide gap. And that's why we've been advocating that government should learn to do exit replacement on time. The eventual problem would be that we may end up not having good health delivery because of lack of qualified personnel in the country.
Okay, so you did say that you mentioned conditions of service, remuneration. Yeah. So who do we... Who can we say is responsible, for this situation?
Obviously, it's government. It's government. But the other truth is that we as citizens have not actually been monitoring our leaders. We tend to look for the easier prey to attack. And that's why you see people vent their displeasure on health providers. While indeed, the health providers are actually working in a very uncompetitive environment. But because we are trained to care for our people. Video going around that doctors swore oath to save life, not to take blames. Because when you have a dying patient coming in, all you want to do is to see what you can do to save the patient. But by the time somebody is now accusing you of murder, then it's demoralizing. So the public need to understand what rights and privileges are. Yes, it's your right to good health, but the truth of the matter is that it's not the doctor, that have the absolute control over providing that good health. The doctors are just using, if I'm going to see 50 patients, for instance, within 8 hours, I will have to do a little bit of compromise for me to be able to meet up with that. Because the truth of the matter, like where I work in Ikorodu, it's a place where if the patient have their means, they can even stab you to death. If you see 99 out of 100, that is the reality that we have. So it's really unfortunate that the public is venting their anger in the wrong place instead of venting it on the government. Government need to account for what they spend on us. And health is one of the main rights of the citizen.
Okay, so government is accountable.
Yes, government is
accountable. All right, before I come to you, Dr. Abdulsalami, Dr. Hosseini, well, you're the chairman of Lagos State NME, and you know you have listed quite a number of issues or factors. Can you tell us what are you doing, you know, as the chairman of your association, you know, to protect the welfare of the doctors and also to checkmate, you know, this trend of brain drain?
Yes, what we've been doing is to, like when I came into office, we actually have a health summit where we try to analyze what are the causes of the problems that we have in health. And we had a summary of the findings, and we are trying to work on how to ensure that those things are under control. But the truth of the matter is that all effort to get government to do the needful has been very difficult. For instance, you have a setting where you have 200 doctors working, and mid-year it becomes 100 doctors. And yet, 1 year down the line, there's no replacement. The exit replacement has remained a big problem affecting the welfare of our colleagues. Because you now have a doctor doing the work of 4 or 5 doctors, and yet nobody wants something to go wrong. When something goes wrong, everybody's health is at stake. You understand? So it makes the health providers insecure in their place, in their supposed comfort zone. So when you are not secure in your comfort zone, then there's a problem. The tendency for you to want to leave. Indeed, current review of what has been happening shows to us that we have an average of 1 to 2 doctors leaving each facility for greener pasture within 6 months. So we have 27 hospitals in Lagos State. So if 1 to 2 doctors leave, that means we have between 30 and 60 people leaving within 6 months. And this is real. Indeed, your subordinates will be planning to leave under your nose. All they want to just do is get their papers, pass their exams, and they leave. And it's understandable if your colleague, one of my very junior colleague that just left for US, his starting salary is $3,000. That's about the salary of the highest paid consultant in Nigeria. So if I'm going to have a starting salary of $3,000 after all expenses,
okay,
you can stop such people.
Well, that's true. It's all about the take home.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, Dr. Abdulsalami. You know, earlier on, Dr. Sally was talking about violence. You know, from the side of the patients, the hospitals, and all that. And you know, you as a doctor, you know, you interact with patients and all that. What's your own view, you know, about this?
Well, thank you very much. Well, just like the chairman earlier said, there have been a number of factors that have been responsible for this brain drain. Look at it two ways: the push factors and then the pull factors. That is, those factors are pushing people away from greener pastures, and the factors that are out there pulling them to those places. Now, in our environment, in addition to all the things that you have said, is the increasing level of violence. People are venting their anger, people are venting their frustration on the health workers. There are poor facilities on ground in those places. The doctor knows so much but can only do little because you don't have the requisite tool to work. So all of these are the things that causes anger in patients. And also, the industry that we are in is such an emotional one. When people lose their dear ones, they tend to be emotional, and in being emotional, state of denial, you want to vent that anger on someone and the readily available person that you can vent that anger on is that healthcare provider, the doctor or the nurse that is involved in this situation. So ordinarily, I mean, assault to health worker is not something that should be condoned. In fact, assault to any human being is not something that should be condoned. I mean, it's a criminal act. Even in our National Health Act, it's already written there that the healthcare provider may refuse to attend to any individual who physically or verbally abuse the healthcare provider. So it's a matter of law. So if a patient or a relative physically or verbally abuse the doctor, then the doctor will have no choice than to protect himself. I mean, either seek refuge in the court or not charge that person to court. So I believe it's because of the non-satisfaction of the services that the patients are getting that is pushing them into all of this, and unfortunately it's having a negative effect on the already stressed doctor or the already worked out doctor, the doctor who is already contemplating on leaving the country. In fact, I mean, a recent study done showed that 8 out of 10 doctors are contemplating leaving the country. That among those ones who are still here, 8 out of 10 are. So a doctor that is contemplating on leaving the country, now he's further burdened by harassment from patients, the economic situation and all the rest. So this are the things that are pushing
the workload. Now, in your own experience, you know, as a specialist in public hospital, you know, we've had cases that, you know, doctors are overworked, you know, doctors do fall ill, some even die, you know, on duty. Have you witnessed, I mean, how often does this happen? Have you witnessed cases like that? As a result of, you know,
yes, what we have witnessed recently is a lot of healthcare issues developing among doctors. We know that being hypertensive, being diabetic has is age related, or if you have a family history, we now have people coming down with hypertension much younger than the age that they should do, and in fact coming down with complications of such illness, and even doctors or healthcare workers who already have those disease conditions have not found time because of the schedule of work to take care of themselves. We now have increasing mental illnesses amongst doctors, but the psychiatrist is at an alarming rate. Doctors are sneaking to go and see their psychiatrists because of the stress of work. You have doctors who are females. Because of the pressure of work, they can't even observe, they can't be exclusive breastfeeding for their children because of the pressure of work. Because of the pressure of work, doctors who are females, it's been a cause of conflicts in their various homes. For instance, I mean, just of recent in last week, we have the medical officers and then we have the resident doctors. The medical officers are the career doctors who just suddenly because of shortage of resident doctors, the government had to convert their services to resident doctors without issuing them any letter to start resident. So I mean, the resident life is more stressful than that of a medical officer. So if you have someone whom you have converted into a resident doctor but he's not getting the financial reward for it, he has just, I mean, the reason why he's not doing residency, is an agreement between himself and the husband. The reason why he's not doing residency is because he feels that the stress of residence is too much for him or her to bear, and then the government is now forcing that same residency on that individual without commensurate financial benefits.
Yes. Okay. Well, thank you for that. Well, viewers, this is still Good Health on Vanguard Live. We are discussing brain drain in the health sector. So we shall be back after this short break. Hello viewers, welcome back to Good Health on Vanguard Live. With us in the studio, we still have the doctors from the Lagos State branch of the Nigerian Medical Association. We have Drs. Hosseini and Dr. Abdulsalam. Now, Dr. Hosseini, you have listed quite a number of issues and factors. What really is the recommendation of the Lagos State NME, the Lagos State government? I'm sure you've been having interaction with the Ministry of Health, Lagos State. So what really are you asking for a solution to these challenges?
Well, thank you very much. Like we have said, the condition of service can only be improved when you have enough manpower. Because if you are a doctor and you do the work of 2-3 doctors, then you are not likely going to give your best. Like you know, the First Lady is one of my members. She's a doctor. She's been MD. So definitely she's aware of some of the difficulties that we have in the system. And she's been trying to do her best. But we all know that she's not the final say when it comes to decision making. So what we have done is to continue to interact with her and give her own advice and submissions. The issue of exit replacement is something that government has to develop a seamless policy. That we have been saying since the beginning of last year. Like we need, if you give me 10 doctors and 2 leave by this month, they're supposed to give me 1 month notice. If they're going to retire, they're supposed to have been informed 3 months earlier. So I should have standby a replacement for those people once they leave. The essence of notification is for the system to prepare replacement. But what we find in the government bureaucracy is that a staff tender his resignation at his place of work, then he doesn't progress down to the person that is supposed to make decision about replacement until maybe 2-3 months. Meanwhile, the resignation is just supposed to be a month notice. So the reality is that if you, for instance, somebody complained about a doctor and the system is proud to say we are suspending him, we are sacking him. The truth of the matter is that when those doctors are suspended or sacked, it is his contemporaries that are actually being punished. Because if you suspend a doctor, for instance, you will only not pay him for the work he has not done. But you will not bring a replacement to do his job. So his contemporaries around there, we have to make up for that deficit. And that would put a weakness in the system. So the exit replacement has to be, if the government is so proud and find it so easy to terminate somebody's appointment, they should also make it to be proud to quickly replace that appointment. Yes, we have a lot of doctors living in the country, but the truth of the matter is that we have a lot of doctors that are jobless, that are seeking employment. So there's no room for government to give an excuse that they don't have replacement. Let's exhaust the number of doctors. Like somebody was suggesting recently that they want to import doctors. The truth of the matter is, how many doctors are you going to import? Then are you going to pay them what you are paying us? Because you import a doctor and you are paying the doctor 3 times the salary that I am demanding for me to stay back, it doesn't make sense. So these exit replacement, both are federal and state, not just state. We have issues at some of the federal institutions in Lagos that we have had to address to the House of Assembly. You hear of the recent threat at Yaba Psychiatry about shortage of staff. So it's a general thing, not just about the state. But the reality is that people make the issue of exit replacement so difficult. If you have budgeted for 100 doctors, and in the middle of the year is 50 doctors, are you going to return the remaining 50 doctors' salary? So what happened to those salaries? So if you have a mechanism in place such that the replacement can be made seamless, once the immediate employer, that's the unit that the officer is serving, to have a direct access to the control, such that, okay, the doctor has tendered resignation, which we have approved. So they make a decision and look for a replacement. And indeed, when they do interviews, for instance, in last week, when they do interviews, they have people on waiting list. So it's not as if you need to now do a fresh interview. Let's go on the waiting list and pick somebody to replace. But that's not what is happening. What we see is a situation where government is trying to save the cost by not replacing. Then when something goes wrong, they blame. Currently, if I must tell you, what we have is that we have a lot of senior officers in service.
So a lot of those senior officers are being made to do the work of the junior officer. Of course, that will not bring satisfaction. So a few of them are resisting this. Because if I'm supposed to be a manager of a company and the next thing you say is because there's a shortage that you come and do the work of the messenger, of course I will resist it. So those are the things that we're having. This exit replacement system has to be improved. Condition of service needs to be improved. Remuneration has to be looked into compared to best practices all over the world. So that you can, let me let you know that currently Nigeria has 1 to about 6,000 one doctor to about 6,000. Yeah. Meanwhile, places like Europe and Britain and America has 2.8 to about 2.5 to 1,000 population, and they are still taking more. You can see when they are removing conditions that will make it difficult for people to come and practice in their country.
Okay, so there should be more, you know, the balance.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much, Doctor. So, Doctor Abdulsalam, can we just have your just a passing word.
Yes, I think in addition to what the chairman has said, because everything is, we need to employ more doctors, we need to improve the conditions of service, we need to build on the infrastructure, because another factor that is making people leave the country is job satisfaction. If you cannot practice what you know, then you have to emigrate to a place where you can actually do the practice. Again, we know that government alone cannot do all of it. Private, government now needs to create the enabling environment to empower the private sector. In most of these developing or developed countries that we talk about, more of the healthcare is being serviced by private institutions, whereas the reverse is here in the country. In South Africa, for instance, you won't just go to a government hospital if you have not been to the private hospital. So government should make available soft loans to private individuals so that they also can employ more doctors, they can help improve the condition of service, they can help grow the infrastructure. Again, government can look at the issue of tax relief for doctors, for the private organizations, so all
it's
government
a,
needs
it's
to
a,
claim,
it's a,
yes.
A, you know, a whole bundle of, a package, it's a package asking for. Okay, we're about rounding up, but as we go, Dr. Hosseini, you know, there has been agitation about the minimum wage, for the white, 30% minimum wage. Now, how much impact will this have? You know, if effected, Lagos State government has, of course, you know, it's a law now, the federal law, so all the states must implement it. So how far do you think this 30% minimum wage will go in Lagos State?
Well, the truth of the matter is that we as a medical body are yet to really get a clear picture of what Lagos State has done as its minimum wage. For instance, I will tell you that my salary dropped below what I had even before the minimum wage came on board. And indeed, the governor declared that he even declared bonus at December. But my December salary was lower than what I had even before the minimum wage. So the first thing is for everybody to bring clear what they call minimum wage. It's not just enough to come on here and say we have commenced minimum wage when the real effect of minimum wage is not there. But the other part of it is that beyond minimum wage, you need the welfare package. If I have a good school that my son or my children can go to, and I don't have to waste money on school, I have a good accommodation that is well catered for, I have a good car that is probably replaced maybe every 3-4 years, and the loan is a soft loan, and government is taking care of such loan and other stuff. Why would I want to travel out? Why would I want to go to what is greener about the pasture?
It's already
the welfare. So if what we have been advocating to government is they should provide avenue for welfare package. The minimum wage is good, but I can tell you that if minimum wage is established fully now, within 6 months, inflation will catch up with it. So it's not just about the financial value. The truth of the matter is that just like some people have been analyzing, 500 Naira, a salary in 1999 is probably more than the 1 million naira or 500,000 naira somebody is collecting in 2000 and whatever. So we need, just like when people say we have increased budget, the budget in 2000 and 2000 that is maybe even 1 billion naira is likely equivalent to a budget of 3 trillion naira in this. So you, when you talk of this increment, you should be able to put it in relative terms. The reality is, financial wise, the civil servant salary is dropping, irrespective of the fact that we are having monetary value increment. So it's dropping. So we need a proper welfare package. I need a house. I have a place I can say. For instance, if the government give a loan to a staff that will run over 10 years, and he knows he services that loan, he already has his house or car, he will not want to leave, because he knows once you leave, you take back your house. So he's the one that is losing. So those are things to use to tell, not by saying I must sign bond. Sign bond for what? When you didn't sponsor me to get training, then you want me to sign bond. So it's a bit of a complex. We have made these suggestions to government. Welfare, a minimum wage is not the ultimate. I think the ultimate is welfare package for staffs. I mean, you see staffs exiting the service. Indeed, why our association at the time started trying to see if we can get landed property for our colleagues is we see people serve after 35 years or 30 years, they end up in some friend's boycotter. If you, as a retired level 17 officer, medical practitioner, is retiring into a friend's boycotter or scouting in some, we have practical examples. You understand that government is also aware. So if you have a future for me, that by the time I'm retiring, I have a house or something to give me comfort of old age, why would I want to run out? A lot of people out there are second class citizens and they're not happy, but they can't come home because the cost is not clear for them. So we need, beyond that minimum wage, we need to provide those welfare packages that we impress people to stay back. I mean, in the early days of medical practice, when you finish as a house officer, you have a car loan, you have a house loan. So why you, indeed then when people go, they will be telling them out there, I should be coming back in 5 years. Because they know the services here, or the facilities here, the condition of service here, is much better than there. People like Professor Michael Van Collick, he traveled out now, he still came back, and he made his impact in University of Ife, he made his impact in last week. We're still remembering him for that. He's one of his trainer. You understand what I'm saying? So okay. If the condition of service is okay, people will stay.
I think it's, you know, it's clear, you know, that has been established, that welfare package, you know, realistic welfare package for doctors will help to curb the brain drain. So viewers, that's it. We've been speaking to the chairman, Lagos State Branch NMA, Dr. Salim, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you very much for
inviting me. And also with him has been Dr. Amaruf Abdusalami, also of the NMA's Publicity Secretary. Dr. Abdusalami,
thank you for
coming very much. So viewers, thank you. We'll see you next time. Smile.